let's jump right in to my pet peeve. For those of you that aren't familiar, you are lucky, but this video is the wolves and moose of Isle Royale, and I'm not going to inflict it on you. I'm being a little unfair to this video because it's a really fascinating study in population dynamics, in how a closed ecosystem like Isle Royale, which for most of the year, animals can't come and go because it's so far removed from the mainland, and how predator and prey relationships are shaped on that island when one of those populations, the wolves, undergoes a drastic decline. And which all sounds really great to me as a scientist, and probably sounds really great to you if you are a science teacher, but I have a major problem with this video. And my problem is that for the past 6 or so years, I've been in and out of various science classrooms as an instructional assistant and as an intern. And every time we get into ecology, we show this video. Every classroom I have been in every school that I have been in, this video has come up. And then I had the opportunity to start at LTS this year, and the previous seventh grade science teacher shared with me her old materials. And right there at the top of the unit plan, there they were again, the wolves and moose of Isle Royale. And for me, they're fascinating, but for the past 6 years, I have sat there through this video and watched the faces glaze over. Because there are two groups of kids that are really into this video. The middle school wolf girls are really into this video because there are wolves in it. And the kids who already see themselves as scientists are into this video. And everyone else has no way of accessing science through this video. I'm gonna be honest with you. I've seen this video 7 or 8 or 9 times now, and I still could not tell you on a map where Isle Royale is. I think it might be in Michigan or Minnesota or one of those other M states, but gonna be honest, not a clue. I could be making that fact up. And that's the problem, is I, as a science teacher, as someone who spent 4 years studying biology, have no connection to this video. How am I going to expect my students to connect to the subjects that I'm teaching them if I start out with something that's got no relevance to their lives whatsoever, unless they're the middle school wolf girls? So, in starting my year out at LTS, my goal was to make a significant change to how we teach ecology. And I'm kind of fortunate that I am the only seventh grade science teacher. So I am the only one in my building that is teaching ecology. So I got to say, you know what? I am not showing the wolves of Isle Royale this year. We are doing something different. So here was my goal in this unit. And my goal was threefold. First, to get them engaged, to get them asking questions and investigating solutions by, second, making them see that every single person who walks through my classroom door, or rather in COVID times, every single person who is in the room when I walk through the classroom door, is a scientist. And to make sure that everyone who is in my classroom can see themselves reflected in the science that we're learning. And to do that, part three, I wanted to make the science personal by building a connection for them to the stuff that they were learning. So here is my mission statement. It's beautifully phrased and you are welcome to read it, but what it boils down to is that I wanted my students to engage in the work of thinking like a scientist by making the material relevant to them and by breaking down the idea that there is any one right way to interact with their ecosystem and that the dominant ideas in our culture for how we as humans exist in our environment are right. Before the unit started, I gathered some data because I'm a scientist. So in my traditional start of the year survey, I snuck in a few extra questions beyond the who are you and what's your experience with science and what are you passionate about and what do you want me to know about you? In between those, there were 10 I statements that were related to cognitive engagement. And those were around topics like whether or not my students asked questions when they were confused, whether or not they had strategies that they employed for understanding material, whether or not they had goals for their learning, and whether or not they talk about their material outside of my class and make connections between what they're learning and other topics. So for these questions, they had to rank themselves from 1 to 4, which really irked them because middle school students love nothing more than selecting that answer right in the middle, and they couldn't do that. So they had to scale themselves from 1 to 4, with 1 being, nope, this doesn't describe me at all, and 4 being, yes, this is me. Overall, what I saw was that my students were willing to ask questions, but they were not at all engaged in making connections between science and the rest of their lives. And I want to show you 2 graphs that show that. This is the most telling for me. The statement that I gave them was, I talk about what I am learning in my classes outside of school. And over 60% of my students were in the that does not sound like me range. Only 12.8%, 5 of my students talk about what they are learning outside of school, or at least did at the start of the school year. And the other one that was very telling for me was, I try to make connections between the things I've learned. Again, more than half of them in that 1 to 2 range, and only 3 students saying, yes, this sounds like me. I make connections between the ideas that I'm learning. So my goal is to change those 2 sets of numbers. And here's where we started. Instead of with the Wolves of Isle Royale, I started with this book. And if you're a science teacher and this isn't on your bookshelf already, this is my shopping recommendation for you for the week. This is Tom Wessel's Forest Forensics, which is based off of his longer book, Reading the Forested Landscape. And if you are a science teacher in Vermont, this book was made for you because this is a field guide to figuring out the history of a New England forest. So I took this field guide and broke it down to make it a little more student friendly, turned it into some real yes or no dichotomous keys where my students could take them out into the woods around our school and use them to draw a conclusion about what our school's land was used for before 1991, when our building was built. So we spent a glorious day out roaming the trails with dichotomous keys in hand, hunting for pillows and cradles, and inspecting trees for scar tissue, and identifying index species that we could use to determine how old the forest around them was in order to draw a conclusion about our place specifically and what the history of it was before we got there. The conclusion that my students mostly reached was that they are convinced that our school was built on an old growth forest. So before we came to that spot, this was undisturbed forest land. And we built on this unit from that foundation, from saying these concepts are relevant to this spot that we are standing on. We can get the big vocabulary and we can talk for hours about what abiotic and biotic factors are and what different types of symbiosis are, but all of these things are happening here. All of these things are things that you as an individual are a part of. So from there, some of the stuff that we did in this unit, I built in some time for them to say, here's what I want to learn about. So based on that, I built some playlists for them to work through around topics like water use, agriculture, because many of my students are farmers and they wanted to investigate that. And one of the topics that I was able to build with some resources shared with me by Judy Dow of Gadakana was a playlist that many of my students engaged with around traditional tribal ecological knowledge based off of my second book recommendation for you for the day, Low Tech by Julia Watson. We did lab work related specifically to Vermont waterways where I gave my students a map and said, okay, here's where my parents live. Here's where we are. I'm driving between the two places. You tell me where to stop. And we're gonna test the water from those places to see which is the healthiest. Lake Willoughby was the winner. Winooski River was the loser in our lab testing. Make of that what you will. Students chose what concepts. I presented them with the broad umbrella of ecology and ecosystems and said, okay, what out of this interests you most? So we spent a week focused on what makes something alive anyways, and how do scientists know if something is alive, including the classic lesson on sewer lice. For those of you that are about to be concerned, sewer lice are raisins in some kind of carbonated beverage, but because they are paired with this fantastic video from Carolina Biological Supply, I can convince any room of students that sewer lice are a real organism, and then they get real grossed out when I start eating them out of the test tube. So to generate a conversation about when I finally revealed to them what the sewer lice are, okay, what fooled you? What made you think that this was alive? And how is this such a hard topic for us to understand? But the ultimate goal in this unit was to get them to hear. To our final project, which was to say, you are a member of this ecosystem. For better or worse, you are a member of your ecosystem. And because you are a human person, you are capable of making more drastic effects than any other single part of this ecosystem. So you have needs as an individual. You have things that you love. How can we meet those needs? How can we fulfill those passions while still meeting the needs of our ecosystem? I turned them loose on identifying topics that were important to them, which ranged everywhere from art and art supplies to sports, which was terrifying for me because I am not a sports person, to farming, to old cars, you name it, they loved it. Whatever they came to me with, we worked together to identify how that topic impacted the ecosystem. So to give one example that I'm going to show you the final product of in a little bit, one of my students is an artist. So this student really wanted to do something related to art. So what we came up with was looking at art supplies and how are those made and could we make them with better materials so that you can still do art while not contributing to the problems of overuse of plastics. Once they had a topic, I turned them loose on some research. They had to come back to me with the answers to four questions. They had to give me some background info just because I can't be an expert in everything. They had to tell me, how does this topic or issue or passion affect our ecosystem? What changes are possible to make? What are people doing already? And if we make these changes on a broader scale, what would the impact be on our ecosystem? And then finally, once they had those answers, they designed some kind of a multimedia project to share what they learned. And the goal here was that they would be sharing it not just with me, but with someone out in the community to try to affect change. Unfortunately, that last bit of that goal was kind of the stumbling block for this unit. I learned that 99% of seventh grade students are not willing to have their work shared with anybody but their teacher. So getting past that hurdle, when you take a look through these slides, all of these are links that you can click through to, but I'll show you just my example student, my artist, maybe if we can load. This is half of this student's poster. The other half is there in that two link. So this student ended up focusing in on two art supplies, ink and paintbrushes, because this student identified that a major problem with art supplies is plastics and how much plastic is used to make the materials that we use to make art. So this student identified how to make their own ink. And then the other half of this poster that you can't see here is that they identified how to make their own hair and wood-based paintbrushes to use with that ink. And the art that is on this poster was partially accomplished with the ink that this student made to demonstrate to me that this was a viable alternative. So they were able to identify not just the plastic, but the actual materials in the ink itself are bad for the environment, but that especially the plastic was a problem. So that making their own ink and making their own brushes would help to mitigate the problem of plastics being tossed into a landfill. Here's the other outcome. So this question has come back to haunt us from the start of the presentation. I talk about the things we learn outside of school. So when asking them specifically about this unit, we started off with 60% of middle schoolers down in this 1 to 2 range. Now, well over 60% instead are in the 2 to 3 range, moving towards talking more about what they're learning outside of class. Unfortunately, this one didn't change as much as I would like. The making connections between what I'm learning and other learning and outside ideas. These numbers stayed fairly consistent from the first survey to the last survey. We had about 50% down in the 1 to 2 range, and 50% is still down there. I think a large part of that is twofold. That part of that was that they did not want to make a connection to the outside because they did not want to share their work. But the other part of that, another major stumbling block that I didn't anticipate with this unit, was a vocal group of students who walked into this final project and informed me that they would only be doing a topic where they could say everything that we as humans are doing is right and nothing should change. So, which has now translated, and we're starting to see that same group of students in the humanities applying those same ideas to their work around politics and history. So part of my next step for this unit, when I teach it again in the future, so I'm going to keep working on this unit, is to find a way to decenter the idea that our way that we as white people in the Northeast Kingdom are doing things is the right way to do things. Part of that is that this unit needs more connection to the Wabanaki people whose land I am teaching on right now. And part of this unit that would exist if these were not COVID times would have been an excursion into Vermont's returned tribal forest lands, which are right up the road from our school, but too far away for us to get to on foot. So we were not able to travel to them this year. And then in the future, I want all of my units to eventually be viewed through this lens. So all of my science units at someday are going to start with, how do I connect these people that live here to this concept? Why does what I want to teach matter to the people that live here? So that I can convince the people that live here that they are scientists. And before I turn these slides off for questions, these two shortened links will take you to this presentation if you want to see those other exemplars, and to the materials that I prepared for this unit. Please feel free to take anything you find in there and adapt it to the people that are learning science where you are. And I'll make sure that both of those links are in the chat before we leave here. But I'm going to turn my screen off so that I can open up the floor to questions.
Thank you so much, Natalie, for that wonderful presentation and that gorgeous one. We were commenting about how you made it so pretty. My eye just caught that. So a beautiful presentation. We are opening up the floor for questions, as Natalie said. Please feel free, if you would like, to type your questions in the chat. I will be monitoring that and posing those to Natalie. But also, if you would like to, please feel free to raise your hand and we will instruct you then to unmute yourselves and ask Natalie directly. So thank you again so much for that. Please, we're opening up to the discussion afterwards for questions.
Sure. Natalie, thank you for your presentation. I really appreciate your enthusiasm related to this topic. So I have a question. My question is, how many students, more about the demographics of your students. So are you teaching children, are there Black children, are there Indigenous children in your classroom? How does that influence your teaching? And you use the word decolonize. Can you talk a little more about what you mean about that and how it's related to anti-racism?
Thank you, Caridad. So yes, my demographics up here in the Northeast Kingdom, it is a very white part of a very white state. So my classes are currently in total, I've got 48 students. And of those, we've got two Black students. And as far as I am aware, no students of any other ethnicities. So it is a very white part of the world, which is really related to why I wanted to teach a unit that is not based in, my teammate is correcting me that we have three students and we do have some that claim Native heritage, but not that they have talked about to me. But for me, when I think about decolonizing, what I'm thinking about is the fact that for most of the science that we teach, what we are teaching is very centered around white male ideas of how the world works. Most of the history of Western science does not acknowledge ideas outside of the history of Western science. So even like if I'm teaching space right now, traditional science classes dictate that I should be teaching about Kepler and Galileo and all of these people who did phenomenal work in helping us understand how science works, right up through Hubble and Hawking. And all of those people that I just named are white men. We don't acknowledge in a traditional unit the fact that Arabic astronomers were the first people to come up with accurate maps of the sky or to calculate the size of the planet Earth. We don't acknowledge the native peoples that keep accurate understandings of the sky and that tell stories based on the stars that we're looking at. So when I talk about decolonizing a science class, what I'm thinking about is this idea that there are, in all of the history of science, so many ideas that don't get acknowledged because they weren't published through the traditional channels of white male science.
Thank you, Caridad, for your question. And thank you, Natalie, for responding. Caridad, I saw that you unmuted. Did you have anything follow up?
Real quick, I don't want to take up. First of all, I also want to thank that Natalie gave a presentation which allowed for questioning. This is very, very important. Thank you. Yeah, I guess what I wanted to say was, do you use these words? And then I'll end there. And if not, are you willing to use words like with middle schoolers like whiteness and white men and white supremacy and things like that?
Oh, yes.
Okay, good.
So to give you an example of something, an easy way to bring that into the science classroom. In my work group, I have an acknowledgement of birthdays. And part of what I acknowledge every month is a famous scientist birthday that has involved things like the fact that we don't know George Washington Carver's birthday because he was born into slavery. And despite all of his great acknowledgements, I can't say happy birthday to him. I have to acknowledge him on the anniversary of his death because we have no idea when he was born. Or other Black scientists who have had their work so belittled that they were not able to work in the field of science, that they went into other fields related like education. So yeah, and I probably don't do as much work about it as I should because I am still white and sometimes it slips my mind, but I do try to make those acknowledgements and use that specific language with my students.
Thank you for that powerful follow-up question, Caridad. I appreciate that. And thank you, Natalie, again, for opening this up for questions. There's a question in the chat from Miranda that says, do you have any strategies for getting students to recognize problems in systems when they think they are doing something perfectly?
So I am not going to promise that this is a perfect strategy, Miranda, but because it did not work with all of my students, But for some of them, what worked really well was to say, okay, this is obviously something that you feel very strongly about. So now go find me the data, because this is science class and we are all about data. So you are going to go forth. We did some work at the start of the year on what a reputable source in science looks like. So I know you know how to find those. So you're going to go out, you're going to find me the data, and you are going to report back on what the data says.
Thank you for that, Natalie. We do have time for a few more questions. Again, please feel free to put your questions in the chat or raise your hand, and we will ask you to unmute. As we're waiting, I wonder if it's okay, Natalie, if I may pose a question.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much. Kind of a follow-up to Caridad is, I'm curious, because you did such interesting discussions around the indigenous people, and I'm going to brutalize the name Abenaki. Am I saying
that? Abenaki.
Okay. Wabanaki, indigenous people who started here. I'm wondering how you can, as you go forward with this type of thing and having them test, to actually kind of center that more. Mm-hmm. And as you know, as you're going out, what can you do to incorporate that as the center, you know, as you're going out into these beautiful lands and these beautiful places, to bring that up and use your science lens, but through that. I'm curious. Thank you.
Right. So in thinking about that, one of the things that immediately comes to mind is I had a part in my unit where we were focused on some, why does this matter? Why does it matter that we learn about ecology? And the first thing that I thought of to pull out was John Muir and his essays on the American wilderness and the importance of keeping wild spaces and preserving ecological relationships. So the first thing that comes to mind with that question, and something that is now going to be part of this unit going forward, is replacing that writing, because it's a powerful writing. But it's also, John Muir was mostly writing about the Sierras and the western part of our country. And I know that Judy Dow and other Native American people in this area have written about the beauty and the importance of this place. So that's the first thing that comes to mind for me, is bringing those voices even more into my classroom. And saying, why does it matter? Well, here are the people that have been here since long before even I was here, and my ancestors were some of the first white people to settle in this place. So this is why it matters. They are going to tell us why it matters.
I have another question and maybe suggestion, and something that I'm grappling with as well, right? I had to write up a lesson. I'm a student teacher now. I had to write up a lesson on, it was called the invasion plan. And I chose what Erica was talking about, centering indigenous people before we ever talk about Columbus or anything like that, but centering them in the curriculum first. And one of the suggestions that I got from Rethinking Schools book was, if there were any indigenous children in the classroom, to let them know what you were going to talk about. And I'm wondering also, so how do we incorporate families of Black children and indigenous children when they are I don't use the word minority, but when the majority are white in the classroom, but even if there's only two Black students or three, that somehow that knowledge, that recognition is in our curriculum, in that place, and how do we encourage those families and those children to be centered in those conversations?
Thank you.
That's actually where my anti-racist curriculum question was, kind of directed. Mm-hmm. To.
Also, good luck with student teaching. I was there last year, so Normal teaching, I have been told, is not like this year. But yeah, I don't know if I have an answer so much to that as an agreement that it would be incredibly powerful to bring the voices of those students and those families whose cultural experiences are so very different from the bulk of my classroom into the conversation. And part of the reason that I'm not sure I have a good answer for that right now is that the short answer to that is that there is really no good way to bring those families into the conversation in my classroom right now, because short of putting them up on screen in Zoom, which a lot of our families, the access might not be there. It's hard to get them involved in the conversation, but I absolutely agree with you that bringing those voices in would be incredibly powerful.
I'm not sure this is a question, it's a wondering. I've been thinking a lot, mostly because of work with Judy Dow, about how eugenics has served as a way of erasing Indigenous people in Vermont. And so when I hear folks, especially in the Northeast Kingdom, say that their students are all white, it makes me wonder if part of that is erasure, because so many Abenaki, Abenaki families had to assimilate to survive and to avoid sterilization and by the state of Vermont, and to avoid being institutionalized by the state of Vermont. And what I've been wondering about is if we had, I've been thinking, I don't expect you to have an answer to this, Natalie. I just love that this keeps coming up for me as you're talking, is if we had a better statewide approach to teaching about the Abenaki, the Abenaki, and the other Indigenous folks that lived on these lands, whose land we are living on, would we have more families feel comfortable sort of owning and claiming their heritage? And I feel like it's a real disservice that we don't teach about eugenics in Vermont, because it continues that erasure in a way that people are going to lose the meaning of that heritage. So I'm just thinking about that.
So I've actually been thinking about that too, Jeannie, and trying to figure out how far I can push the envelope with my students and my administration, because one of the units that I get to hit before the end of the school year, the way we've got our science curriculum divided up, is I get human body. And one of the thoughts that I had around that unit was to spend some time on what makes us look different and why it is that we perceive these differences in such a negative way and treat these differences so differently and with such anger and violence, and really pushing them at that notion of how much more alike we are than we are different. So that was a foundation that I was wondering if I could get away with for my human body unit. And I may be pushing into that later this year. So I'll let you know how it goes.